Mark Novak of Mark's Home Team, thanks for being here.
Yeah, well, thanks for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Absolutely. So tell us a little bit about what you do.
Well, I'm a real estate agent. I've been a licensed real estate agent in Harford County for the last 20 years. And presently what I do is come up with creative ways to create additional demand for the properties that my clients are trying to sell. Mm. And then, of course, in a market where it is a strong seller's market and you find yourself competing with multiple offers as a home buyer, I'm coming up with unique ways to make my clients' offers stand out to make sure that theirs is accepted over, you know, the seller's, you know, five or half dozen other choices.
Is that happening right now?
Yeah, it's happening with you know, reduced inventory combined with you know, very low interest rates,
right,
and lenders that are still lending. There is quite a demand. I think we have what I like to call the cabin fever effect as well. Been doing this for 20 years, and I can tell you almost inevitably after we have a snowstorm or any type of period where people are locked in their house, even if it's a month or a week, I get more calls. People want to get out and look. They realize how much they, you know, are growing out of their house. So you lock them in their house for 2 months, I think, you know, we're going to see the effects of that. So, yeah, a lot of people are getting cabin fever. The market is certainly strong. With that, though, you know, I would say, and it's very strange because you can see it happen as markets change and, you know, maybe and it becomes almost like there's this perception that it's easy to sell a home because it's a seller's market.
Right.
You know, people will gravitate towards less experienced agents or maybe feel like the agent doesn't play as a pivotal role.
Oh, I got you.
Right.
When they're selling their home.
Correct. Mm. And that is, that's a huge misstep because in a seller's market, I should not be seeing properties that are sitting on the market for 3-4 months, okay? Because if you're on the market beyond just 3 weeks in this market, there's already going to be somewhat of a stigmatism on the property. People are going to think, what's wrong with it?
Right. What are the usual landmines people do when they go to sell their home?
Well, you know, it's funny, but, you know, it's just knowing, it's really understanding pricing, condition, and how those things relate to each other and how they work to ultimately determine your price, your list price.
Okay.
And condition in this, I would say probably in the last 5 years, has eclipsed square footage as far as importance for a home buyer.
Really?
So, you know, the old cliche, location, 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 right? That's the number one influencer of value. That's why, you know, a small Cape Cod and Baltimore City might sell for $200,000, but if you put that house in the same exact house in Beverly Hills, it's going to be $2 million,
right?
Because of the location. You know, and then square footage was always a huge impact. You would notice like a very big house would have a lower price per square foot than, let's say, a smaller house. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the more square footage you had, the more, obviously, money you were going to sell for. And then condition, you know, always played a role. But I don't know why that change has come, and I don't know if it's just because of what I call like the HGTV effect, where everybody expects the home to be renovated and just perfect for them. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't get, like when I started in this business, everybody, you were going to buy a house, you were planning to paint and things like that. But now that all has to be done, because if the house isn't compelling, it's not selling.
Really?
So
what would make a house compelling?
Well, the condition or the price?
But like specifically the condition in the interior.
Well, you know, when we're staging a property, because we stage every property because we understand the significance of presentation and what we present to the marketplace, and we only get one shot to make a first impression. Mm. So, you know, using professional photography is great, but if you're not setting the stage, they're not going to capture great pictures. The pictures, they might be good pictures, but they're not great pictures.
And the first impression being the online photos.
The online view, absolutely. I mean, online is where we're going to fulfill demand, but it's also where we're going to create demand.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and we take a two-pronged approach. We want to create an audience, but we also want to fulfill the demand that's already there. What would that look like? Zillow, Realtor.com, Trulia. People are there to look for houses.
Right.
So you're going to be there to fulfill that demand. Demand creation is something that we're very successful at, and we do that through a lot of social marketing, targeted marketing, where we can present the property where people may be looking, but not necessarily looking for property.
Mm.
And one of the ways that I know that that's effective is I list a property and I'll get, you know, three offers from people that don't even have their house on the market yet.
But it's
so those people weren't actively looking. They saw the marketing piece. It was compelling. You know, they've had a thought, obviously, of selling, or they wouldn't be going through this. They were just waiting for the right property to come along.
So you found them probably not through Zillow or whatever.
Correct. So those buyers were influenced through our what we call demand creation aspect of marketing.
And it's interesting because when you started this interview, you mentioned kind of the seller side and the buying agent side, right? So mm-hmm. when you're working in this industry, do you have to separate the two?
Oh, absolutely. Now, you know, obviously, a lot of our sellers are also buyers. So I'm not sure what you mean in separating them. Are you talking about like the same transaction?
Well, like as the agent, it seems like you have to think of this, all these things of selling the house, getting it out there, you know, making it look good. And then when you're buying it, what goes into that when someone's buying a house?
Right.
So we've talked about the selling. If you have someone who's a buyer, then how do you?
Well, when you're working with a buyer, you know, and having an experienced agent as for your listing agent obviously is important because that's a huge investment. And the wrong agent can cost you thousands of dollars, maybe not even on the sales price. Yeah, they can. Mm. You know, anybody can sell a house in a seller's market if you present it properly. But what about in the negotiation process? You know, I just settled a property less than 2 weeks ago, Rancher in Forest Hill. We were in this negotiation process during the inspections. He was ready to relinquish and give the buyer $6,000. You know, we took a little bit of a risk, but he understood that, you know, where we were at, where the buyer was, what the situation was. I was looking at everything. He's only looking at his circumstances.
Right, right, right.
I got to get out of here. I don't want anything to screw this up. So he's making an emotional decision to give up $6,000. Mm. I brought him down. I said, look, calm down. We're not going to lose this buyer. We don't have to give up the $6,000. At least I don't believe we do.
Right. And you get a feel for talking
Correct.
To other agents.
You know, yes. You know everything. You're kind of looking at all of it. And, you know, the buyer did ultimately pull back the $6,000. We didn't give the $6,000.
And it still went through.
But if that would have been an unexperienced agent, if the seller's willing to give the $6,000, they know the deal's going to keep going. They want to protect, maybe they want to keep the deal together.
Right.
Sure, let's give them the $6,000. It's
Different
your money,
priorities.
Not mine.
Right, right.
But I knew I just had a feeling like we don't have to give up the $6,000. And if you don't have to give it up, I don't want you to. That's, you know, that comes with experience. It comes with understanding. It comes with, you know, understanding negotiations. And sometimes negotiations isn't what you say. It's what you don't say.
Mm. Yeah, that part of your industry has always intrigued me.
Right? Like, don't reply yet. Let them sit. I've gotten counteroffers from people without even making a counteroffer. They're counteroffering their own counter just because I sit and just wait.
And their confidence erodes.
Right.
Mm.
What's going on? You know, and who you work with absolutely matters, good market or bad. If you're interested in protecting your interest, you're protecting your bottom line. And again, the transaction is bigger than the sales price. There's lots of ways, you know, a seller can lose money or a buyer can lose money negotiating the life cycle of a transaction.
Tell me about that.
Again, getting back to negotiating inspections, repairs, you know, closing costs. There's a myriad of things that pop up where, you know, understanding the nature of the circumstance and looking at all the pieces, not just the narrow view, you can usually find ways to save money.
Now, because the seller's market, one of my friends is selling his house, buying another house, mm-hmm. but the buyer of his house, the one he's selling, I got really confusing there, but basically he's selling his house, someone's potentially buying it, there's three offers.
Mm-hmm.
He did not take the highest offer. The person that got the bid, won the bid, wrote a letter.
Mm-hmm.
It's old school, but it worked.
Yeah.
I haven't seen that in a while or heard about that, but I was surprised. And he's like, it was a compelling letter.
Yeah, absolutely.
And they're all, aside from that, the deal seems strong,
mm-hmm.
like financially. And instead of taking a chance at a higher level, let's just go with the, you know.
Yeah, and that's another unique aspect of the real estate transaction in that it is a business transaction, but it's also a highly emotional one.
Mm.
And those emotions can be used. Like I said, you know, my client my seller client in that circumstance was emotional because he understands he needs to get out of this house. So he was willing to make an emotional decision. You have sellers that are emotionally attached to their home. It's their home. It's not just a thing, okay? It's where they raise their kids. So, yes, if you can appeal to that emotion, you can get that seller to do something that may not be in their best financial interest, right? But, again, there may have been more to that offer, too, because, like I said, having that agent on the buy side is important because, you know, that seller or that listing agent who took the lesser offer also understands one very important phenomenon, and is that, you know, the only thing worse than not selling your house is selling your house and then it doesn't close because financing falls through. Especially when there's a lot of pieces involved, right? Because now you've got your whole life on a moving truck. You've got several other families that are depending on this transaction to go through.
Right.
And it doesn't. So that can create a tremendous amount of stress, anxiety, and put people in a very bad way. So having a strong offer and a strong sense that it's going to close can give you leverage in other areas. Like you said with your friend, it gave him leverage to get the house for less money because he had a stronger strength to close plus, you know, the emotional connection with the seller.
Right.
Right. But those things all played together and, you know, ultimately is a win for your friend.
Right.
And that's all I care about is putting my clients in a position to win, whether they're buying or selling.
That's it right there.
And there's winning. And like I said, it's not just winning the sale. It's winning the home inspection negotiation and
the time.
Yeah.
Like you said, if the deal falls through, what a waste of time.
Right. And repairs are a big one. I've even HOA repairs. You know, I just settled a condo for a beautiful, beautiful woman, older lady. Loved her to death, super sweet, but she got a notification from the condo board that the property failed inspection because the windows were dirty.
Okay.
Right? And I'm like, we just, you know, the normal response to that is, oh, well, it's not approved, so we have to clean the windows, you know, whether it costs you a couple $100 or you got to do it yourself. She's like, Mark, I really don't feel like doing it. You know, the windows are very heavy. I can't deal with it. In a situation like that, I probably would have cleaned the windows, but I just decided to say that I responded back. We're just not cleaning the windows. And it just went away.
It just went away.
You know what I mean? Like, it was crazy. So, but, you know, that's just another little instance where you just, you can't be afraid to push.
And that's your instincts, been doing this so long. Mm-hmm. So if I were to buy a home and the home needed some things to be fixed, typically, are those things to be fixed by the seller? Will they fix them?
It all depends. Again, every situation is going to be different. You know, and that's another thing too that we pride ourselves on is understanding the nuance requirements for various loan types and understanding that, you know, you may love this house, but here's some things that I see that your lender might not love. And if the seller's not willing to fix them, you're not going to get your financing. So, you know,
it's like first-time home buyer stuff?
There's first-time buyer, even second-time buyer. It doesn't matter. Any type of... It depends on what the loan is. Mm. So, you know, making people aware of those and giving them the opportunity to make those informed decisions of the risk, right? Because an agent who may not be aware might just allow that buyer to go ahead and take the risk of purchasing that home.
And then it could fall apart.
And then it falls apart, right? But they didn't have they didn't know that it could fall apart.
Right, right.
So they weren't able to make the decision, do I take the risk or not?
But day one, you're thinking of it. You see the thing, right, and you're like, I know this.
Here's what you need to be aware of. Understand that, okay? So your home inspection is not going to be cheap. It's going to be between $400 and $600. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to pay for that. And then we're going to pay another $500 for an appraisal. Okay, so now we spent $1,000 to find out that the lender's not happy with the condition of this property because there's peeling paint on that back corner.
And they get the appraisal.
And the seller doesn't want to fix it.
The lender gets the appraisal and they look at this thing.
Correct.
Right.
So they're saying, okay, well, as a condition of the financing, need this, and this needs to be addressed on the physical structure of the property. And the seller says, well, you know, I'm selling it as is. I'm not fixing those things. Now you're at a...
That's it right there.
You're at a standstill, right?
So I'm trying to put myself in your shoes. You have a new client. They're going to buy a home. So you're literally walking through homes with them.
I do, yes, absolutely.
What do you see the most, like, a turnoff for a buyer?
Smells.
Smells.
Yeah. And I, you know, I've done my own research and my own, you know, understanding of psychology or whatever. And I feel like I attribute it to, again, getting back to the emotion.
Mm.
The purchase of a home is an emotional decision in as much as is logic.
Right.
Right. I think the logic ends on the decision to purchase. Right. I'm paying a mortgage regardless.
Mm.
It makes logical sense to buy my home. Right. Which home I'm going to buy is going to be emotional.
Interesting.
Which house feels right.
Yeah.
Right. So the sense of smell is one of your six senses, but it's also the scent that's most associated with memory and emotion.
Hmm.
So I feel like that's probably why that one is so strong as an influencer.
You've walked into a house and your buyers...
If it doesn't smell, if it stinks, most buyers don't even want to look. they don't even want to look.
Like dog or whatever.
Dog, cigarette, any kind of offensive odor, really.
Hmm.
You have some curry.
Yeah.
I've been in houses that have a strong curry smell or a strong oil smell. If people use a lot of oils in their cooking and things like that, where it just permeates into the drywall or any soft surfaces or whatever.
How do you combat that if you were on the other side?
Well, staging.
Just stage.
I'm not going to pretend like it's not going to matter.
Right.
I'm going to be very honest with my seller, you know, and we're going to address it. We're going to address it either with pricing. We're going to address it physically and make it not an objection. Ideally, that's the way we want to go. I do a market analysis, and I can tell you, okay, here's our price, okay, and here's your highest price analysis. This is what this is the most we could expect to get this house if it had everything every buyer was looking for.
Just perfect.
Right? So if we brought my stager in here, and she gives you a list and you do everything on that list, I can pretty much guarantee we're going to be on this highest price analysis. Some houses are already there, but most aren't.
Right.
And most of them, it's just some small tweaks. But I at least want to give the opportunity for the seller to say, okay, well, my house is worth $300,000 right now. That's great. It's more than I thought. But if I spend $5,000, now my house is worth $330,000.
There's that kind of ROI potential?
There is. The delta is that big right now between the best house and the best value.
Wow.
So it's imperative that we at least allow them to make that opportunity.
Hmm.
I just went to one in Dundalk yesterday. Great house. As is, $140,000.
Mm-hmm.
Great little house. Beautiful starter home. If we renovated it, and I've got contractors that will work with them to do it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Probably be about $50,000 or $60,000, but the house would be $249,000.
Wow. So how do you work out those finances? What if they don't have the cash right now?
Well, one of the things I'm working on is I'm trying to work with some local lenders to do like maybe a 0%, like a 6-month loan where
right.
people could have no payments, no interest. Because this is really ultimately that the people that do that, and I've had a few people that have done it with great success. It's not easy, and it's very stressful, especially for me, because I'm taking on the responsibility of managing that project,
oh, you're
right?
Yeah.
And, you know, people are going out on a limb. But, you know, I feel like if I'm willing to take that risk if they are, okay? Because I believe in the end result, and I know how people can benefit and how much it can have an impact on their life.
It's a huge... huge potential return.
Yeah, if you're talking about an extra $30,000, you know, basically I'm just treating people like an investor, because an investor would go buy that house for $140,000 and then flip it. Why can't that homeowner experience the same just because they don't have access to contractors that will actually show up and do the job, or they don't know what they need to do, etc. So we just kind of take the guesswork out, and I at least offer it as a potential.
Right, so it's on the table.
Mm-hmm.
Are the kitchens kind of like the thing to renovate?
Yeah, kitchens, bathrooms. Yeah. We have ways, you know, that we can do it relatively inexpensively. Our staging is more of, we focus on the physical structure, and we're looking at very small ways to have a big impact. I think spending, you know, $5 to get 15 type deal.
Mm.
But, you know, it's hardware, it's fixtures, obviously painting, lighting. Lighting is huge. Lighting and paint, you know, and again, smells.
Smells. Are you
eliminating smells? You don't want to mask them.
Okay.
Masking a smell is worse than eliminating it, or than having it.
You have 20 candles on in the house, and you walk in.
Yeah, that can create a bad situation.
The hardware, is it the silver, or is it the...
It all depends on the structure, and yeah. You know, a lot of it is lighting. A lot of it is the... we're not bringing in new furniture, okay. So what is going to present the best? And I leave that up to the stager.
Just do your thing.
But right now, we're seeing nickel. We're still seeing chrome. We're seeing a lot of oil rub bronze. And I think, I don't see that really changing. I do see it's like an unpolished brass, I think, or something that's going to start to become popular.
Yeah,
well, because brass, you know, is a natural antimicrobial.
Right.
And I just feel like in this heightened sense of awareness of viruses and germs, I think once that becomes, you know, once manufacturers start pushing that idea.
That's a good idea.
You're going to see it. You're going to see it make a comeback.
I've never heard of that, but that's a great idea.
So just be on the lookout for that. It's coming.
Okay. Well, Mark, I appreciate your time. Is there anything you want to hit on before we wrap up?
No, man. I appreciate you having me here and letting me run my mouth for a few minutes. Man, it's cool.
Thanks, Mark.
Yeah, absolutely, bro.